I'm John Batchelor. Mary Kissel's here with me, my colleague and co-host from the Wall Street Journal. And there are other headlines. Believe it or not, the world is not always on fire. There is policy to discuss. And we're going to start with a piece of policy that I've been following, thanks to editorials and news reports about the Consumer Protection Bureau, my credit card, and the banks, and a very famous Harvard law professor who is magnificent on television, does Comedy Central, and is extremely good and close with the Obama administration. Her name is Elizabeth Warren. Elizabeth Warren heads an agency that is undefined at this moment, and Mary and I have been in discussion about it, and Elizabeth Warren is testifying to Congress about the ambitions for her agency some 24, 48 hours ago. How did the Congress receive Ms. Warren?
Well, John, this is the first time that we've seen Ms. Warren in many, many months, so Congress had a lot to ask her. This agency, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, better known as the CFPB, is unlike any other agency in government. It is basically unaccountable. It's unaccountable to Congress. The woman who was running it, Ms. Warren, has been appointed. Its rules will be extremely difficult politically to overturn. It's unconstitutional.
Appointed, that means there was no nomination hearing?
That's right. The president did an end run around Congress. This is the one check that Congress has over an agency that is going to set rules, think about this, for every single credit-making institution, with a few small exceptions for carve-outs for lobbies, in the country. Think about that.
One of the details that I've learned, Mary assigns me these reading tasks, and in between watching the Fukushima disaster, I've been watching that the presentation includes the mortgage lenders, the big banks, to put together what, a slush fund? How do you describe this? A $20 or $30 billion dollar carte blanche fund to be used to delay, extend, otherwise forgive mortgages that are either underwater or hopelessly behind. And that this fund can be used at the discretion of Ms. Warren and her lieutenants indefinitely, especially for the year 2012. Did I say that all correct?
Wow, that's a lot to that is a lot to process. This euphemistically called quote unquote settlement arose out of the robo-signing scandal last year. And state attorneys generals, along with the Justice Department, and yes, Ms. Warren and the CFPB, and this was confirmed in congressional testimony yesterday, decided that they wanted to go further than the normal federal regulatory process. And what they wanted to do was to say to the big mortgage servicers, we think the robo-loan scandal was really bad, and it's so bad that we think that you should pay 22, some numbers out there, are $30 billion. You should just give it to us. Doesn't matter that you didn't originate the loans. Doesn't matter that you probably don't own them. You're a big bank and a big mortgage servicer, and we think that that's bad.
And and that money is just pooled together to at the discretion of the...
Whom?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a great question. It's a great question. As I said, and this is an agency, and Congress probed Ms. Warren on this a lot yesterday, but they didn't get any good answers. They asked her, your agency doesn't actually get rulemaking power until July. How is it legal that you are involved in this quote-unquote settlement process? And she didn't answer the question. What she did say is, we cannot be a formal party to the agreement. Well, that's self-evident, because it's not an agency with rulemaking power.
Elizabeth Warren, congressional testimony to be continued. Second item, for many years I've spoken with Mary about Tibet. After the conflict in Lhasa in the March of 2008, which is 3 years ago right now, Mary was careful to report to me from Hong Kong that Tibet had gone dark. And I didn't understand that at the time, but now I do 3 years later. There's no good reporting coming out of Tibet. You have to be signed on and escorted around. We have a significant event, I think. A 24-year-old Tibetan monk died this day, 12 hours ago, less than 24 hours ago, after setting himself on fire around 4 p.m. local time, March 16th, in Aba County, in the Aba Tibetan Chang Autonomous Prefecture, in China's Sichuan province. That's eastern Tibet. That's, it used to be part of the great state of Tibet. Tibet is a vast land. This part of Tibet towards where the earthquake was in 2008. According to local government's spokesman, Xinhua reported, Chinese police rushed to a nearby hospital. However, others removed him from the hospital and he died in the monastery around 3 a.m. What is the significance to you, Mary, that a Tibetan monk, in protest, we believe, kills himself by setting himself on fire?
Well, we've seen this before. It's very disturbing. This monk, it was reported that he yelled out, "Long live the Dalai Lama, long live the Dalai Lama," as he did this. It was reportedly in protest to the Chinese occupation to mark the three-year anniversary. You know, China's game here in Tibet is basically to outlive the Dalai Lama and then to install their own leader as the head of the Tibetans. But what they don't realize is that if they don't make any concessions whatsoever to the Tibetans, you could see the movement start to radicalize. And we've seen this among the youth. We saw a couple of young people set themselves on fire in India several years ago. This is very sad. It's not a good outcome for anyone. For China nor for Tibet, and I think this monk's self-immolation is a sad and tragic event.
Mid-March 2011, a young man sets himself on fire and dies in protest of a tyranny. Mid-December 2010, a young man sets himself on fire in Tunisia. It started a wildfire that continues throughout the Ummah. In China, they call it the Jasmine Revolution. Mary Kissel of the Wall Street Journal. Thank you very much, Mary.
Thank you, John.
I'm John Batchelor.